what it feels like to be on the sharp end.
And there's a lot that goes on up there in your head.
That's always been the scariest part in climbing, right before you're going to fall.
How far can you push yourself knowing that if you slip, you're screwed?
I figured, well, this just must be what separates the men from the boys. And that's when I went, oh man, you're gonna fall.
When you're out there on the sharp end, things can go wrong.
You're not gonna be able to push it that long. At some point, shit is gonna hit the fan.
And you have to say to yourself, I could die today.
You have to be out there on the lunatic fringe, so to speak.
We live in a world of tightly organized safety. And yet, there are those among us who seek out the edge. On the fringe of our society, out there in the hills, there's a mutant strain of fear-tolerant individuals in open rebellion against the laws of safety. For generations, they've been laying it out on the line, risking it all for a moment of glory on the sharp end. To document this tribe of danger seekers, we'll join up with the boldest among them on their quest for thrills around the world.
Follows me around, but it's not heaven sent.
Our journey begins in the climbing mecca of Boulder, Colorado. There's a tradition of hard, scary climbing that has been flourishing here since the 1970s. When lines were established in a way that minimized protection and guaranteed adventure. In the years since, bolt protection has allowed climbers to focus on pure difficulty. But today, a group of young guns is bringing back the bold, traditional methods, foregoing the safety of bolts and placing their own gear on ultra-hard, naturally protected routes.
There's a movement towards seeing what you can do on gear.
Searching out for lines that we can climb that are just as hard as your hard sport climbs, but track climbs.
Just blew this guy out on that fall.
That's what inspires us.
It is fun. It scares the shit out of me.
Just fucking going for it. That's what it is, it's just going for it.
There's something awesome about doing a route and placing gear that adds this extra mental challenge. You place a piece of sketchy gear and you just think about what's going to happen when you fall. But then you just totally convince yourself that the gear is good and that you don't have to worry, you can just focus.
Mastering the art of natural protection has allowed Boulder's elite few to establish groundbreaking first ascents and to push traditional climbing to a whole new level of difficulty.
You're out there and you have to rely on your climbing ability and your confidence to get you through the moves.
While Boulder's new generation is redefining the possibilities of hard trad climbing, perhaps nobody lays it out on the line more often than El Dorado resident Hank Kaler.
Is this Hank's place?
Yeah, this is Hank's place.
Nice.
His dog just threw up on the floor, so you're in.
No, my dog just chundered all over.
Hank is among the boldest climbers in El Dorado Canyon.
Good times in Eldo, living in a trailer with a mastiff that barfs everywhere. At least it's not a big turd.
He's got a reputation for risky capers and self-inflicted injuries.
I grew up playing hard, playing rough, but hanging out with the wrong crowd.
After 39 years of broken limbs,
look at my leg!
Head injuries.
It's called a horseshoe procedure.
And brushes with the law.
Handcuffed me to a gurney, naked, and stuck 250 stitches in my body with me.
Hank is still making headlines. Every
time I jumping off the Embassy Suites Hotel in Denver, my chute opened backwards, and I barely had time to go, fuck! And then, boosh! And I'm like whitewashed in blood, sitting there next to a bed going, dude, you're back inside the building. It was just the biggest mind fuck I could imagine. Like, oh, you're gonna be on the news.
These days, Hank's been hanging with his bros in Eldo Canyon, climbing so-called death routes.
I got nothing better to do after work. You know, might as well go get scared. The lion. If you blow any of the hard moves, your belayer better be yanking some slack up or you're gonna hit the ground, shattering everything from the waist down. Your soul has to be redlined. It's when you can focus the most. Being dangerous is when I'm most comfortable and, you know, once a decade, it blows up in my face. But other than that, fuck it, man. I'll deal with the consequences. It keeps daddy happy, keeps me sane. I might be a funny personality, but, you know, you just can't compete with, like, Matt Siegel and those guys. They're doing what I'm doing, but, like, a number grade harder.
24-year-old Matt Siegel is a staunch believer in using Natural Pro, no matter how hard the climb.
Why do this instead of a 513 sport climb?
Because this is way more bitchin'.
And perhaps no route in the area upholds trad style in the face of difficulty more than Must Have Been High, a notorious X-rated line in El Dorado Canyon. The route's entire 513 crux is protected by a single half-inch knife blade.
For the difficulty, it's probably the scariest of all the harder trad climbs in the Boulder area. If the knife blade rips, you're probably gonna get really, really hurt. It's insecure slapping up this refrigerator block. Definitely scary. You're like the most run out from the pin, and then you get to place a small stopper. You have to deal with the mental aspect of being on lead. It's just all about kind of keeping your shit together, not letting your wheel spin too much while you're up there. You get like a purple C3 size piece. All I have to do is like one move up. After I took the whippers, totally spooked, just like threw me off. I was like, why? Like, is it really worth it? You know, it's definitely a question that comes up. But for the most part, try to stay focused and not even think about that kind of. Tied back in and did it that day. Afterwards, the reward is definitely worth it.
Fuck yeah! Woo!
The sharp end has no strict definition. Literally, it's the end of the climbing rope where the leader ties in. But there are many styles of climbing out there, and lots of ways to get your danger fix. And for some people, the sharp end is found when you leave the rope on the ground.
Highball bouldering.
Basically, bouldering stuff that really ought to have bolts in it. That seems like a fine way to get yourself broken up.
Come on.
That just freaked me out.
Lisa Ranz is the reigning queen of highball bouldering.
I've always been attracted to high, hard, scary boulder problems.
She's living proof that the danger gene is not just a dude thing.
Women realize we can go out there and have just as much fun as the boys. I really like to put myself out there on the line.
Come on.
30 feet off the ground, you really have to focus to relax yourself. I feel I'm trying to push myself physically and mentally when it comes to my climbing. About 7 years ago, I moved to Bishop to really try to focus on doing high, hard boulder problems. I live here with my husband, Wills.
Bishop has always been a center of highball bouldering. It's always been a place where the boulders are larger than life. Climbing for me is just an enjoyable thing to do, and it's a very personal thing. I don't climb for anybody else. I climb for my own pleasure. But I feel like for Lisa, it's more than that for her. She's really driven to be the best at what she does.
Sometimes you're pulling so hard, you do movements that seem virtually impossible. High off the ground, you have to flip your mind from this raw power to a very calm state. So I've spent the last few years really focusing on learning to control my mind. A mission I've had for a while has been to climb this side of paradise. It's an overhanging arete, and it continues well into the no-fall zone.
It was one of those lines that everybody knew about, everybody took a look at. Everybody went home thinking, my gosh, no way. It's really big, it's really hard, and very intimidating. You have to push it high off the ground.
Okay, no.
It's pretty amazing how tall that thing is.
Lisa, come on. Give it a go. Come on, you can do it. A little high, pinch it. Get it. Come on.
As you get higher off the ground, the holds just sort of disappear.
Go on. That's it, Lisa. Come on. Give it a go. You can do it.
Oh, I can't do it.
Go on, try it.
I can't do it. I'm too shaky. And your feet are probably 25 feet off the ground.
Oh my God.
And no matter how much foam you have under you, it hurts. Your whole body compresses. That was an eye-opener. It made me realize you definitely can't fall any higher. You're really gonna get hurt.
Gnarly.
I waited a few days before going back, and I just kept beating myself up over the fact that I wouldn't commit. I must have climbed the side of paradise in my sleep 500 times.
Even though it is frightening for me to watch her climb some of the things she's done, I do have total confidence that if she thinks she's gonna do it, she's gonna do it.
Come on,
I knew what to do, I simply had to mentally commit to doing it, to go for it, give it 100%.
Come on, Lisa. That's it. That's it, Lisa. Come on. Go on.
I love to achieve that mind control, to almost lose it, and instead you just calm down 100% and focus on the task at hand.
Our journey among the bold keeps us on the move, from Colorado to California to the high Himalayas.
The Shafat Fortress, right there, it's like really, really want to climb it.
Oh, man.
Got to cross the river, set up a Tyrolean. All our equipment across. Johnny's gonna swim in for us.
We gotta cross this river somehow.
In the big mountains, you may have to tie into the sharp end before you even get to the climb.
It's like this. Oh, come on, dude. I want the full implement.
You got
old
it.
Old school.
Ah! Okay. Ah! All right, give us the intro.
I'm Johnny. This is Alpine River Swim.
Woo! Oh, there we go. Go, 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 go.
We need the water!
Go, 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 go! Go, Johnny! You're almost there! Woo!
If alpine climbing is a lifestyle, then Johnny Kopp is living the dream. Traveling the world and making full commitment alpine-style ascents.
Johnny's like the Randy Macho Man Savage of alpine climbing. You're up there, you're tired, like, snap into a Slim Jim, we're gonna go to the summit right now! You're just like, whoa! He's like the most psyched guy in alpine climbing, for sure.
Big missions, big adventures, remote regions that haven't been seen too much. Yeah, it's definitely the most fun type of climbing for me.
Johnny's approach is fast and light, carrying the bare minimum of gear so he can get to the summit in a single, continuous push.
I have two ropes. And maybe one pack, maybe no bivy gear.
And I don't have a headlamp, because I dropped it.
Well, we're going to top out tomorrow before.
But see, we're not going to need it. That was the whole plan here.
But alpine style can leave you seriously exposed.
Fuck.
You're really not having that much fun while it's happening.
Oh, yeah, this,
dude, that wind is
not
going to fucking suck the fucking juice right out of us, man. You know, this problem with doing life.
And we want to do it first try, you know, sit out a storm, do whatever it takes.
This is our third day up on the mountain. Micah just got done with a really wet waterfall pitch. It looked horrendous.
A little cold now.
Micah can laugh off some pretty crazy situations, and that's super important in the big mountains.
I should have stayed at the Boulder Rock Club.
He's a funny motherfucker, man.
I've worn yarmulkes bigger than this baby spot.
There's a big chance of failure on a lot of these missions. That makes it all the more fun if you do succeed in the end.
Made it! The summit of the Shafat Fortress.
Yeah, we're so psyched!
Johnny and Micah's search for alpine first ascents is worldwide. Wherever steep, unclimbed terrain can be found.
So we're here in Chamonix now. It's the springtime. We came here to climb ice, rock. North faces are in great shape right now.
I'd never been to Chamonix before and was just completely blown away by the scale and the access to some of the most amazing alpine climbing in the world. It's a really funky form of climbing, snow over granite. Pretty sloppy stuff.
Climbing with little gear and snow and rock and ice and these mixed conditions that are so hard to manage. Johnny has that stuff really dialed. It's pretty cool.
Yeah! Nice.
The tradition of alpine risk-taking runs deep in the French Alps. And generations of climbers have conquered lines here, or died trying.
To put a new route up here is pretty much impossible. All the plums have been picked. The one place that might have potential is the west face of the Drew, because about half of the whole entire mountain fell off 10 years ago. It has this really ominous white rock scar, and everyone in town's like, you're crazy, you guys can't go up there. But we went up there. You know, classic Colorado cowboy style with one little pack and just start climbing. Starting out on some really cool mixed terrain up these rock corners with some ice in the back of them.
Oh, screaming barfies in my hands, real bad.
And then it turned to pure rock.
We got about halfway or so up the wall, and a big storm came in, encrusting the whole face in ice. We spent the night on a small little perch up there.
Hunkered in for a pretty uncomfortable night. Considering that the storm's gonna build, you definitely don't want to be up in that situation for too long with the limited equipment.
Cold night up here on this tiny little snow ledge.
Brr.
Your only choice is to go down.
We were just at the base of the wall, like, woo, wow, the west face of the Drew didn't kill us. That's great.
Sitting there, like, chucking our gear off, super psyched. And all of a sudden, we hear this crack behind us, and these two VW-sized blocks of ice are coming down. And I just saw Micah's heels get clipped by the edge of one of these big chunks of ice.
The whole freaking thing went, and we just ran for our lives.
It gives me pause once in a while, thinking about the close calls.
It definitely is a moment of reflection and just, you know, how fragile we are in the alpine environment.
I've had friends and partners who've paid the ultimate price for climbing in the big mountains.
So if the price of failure is so high, why take the risk?
I don't know how to answer the question of why I do this.
I don't know. I don't know if there's really an answer. It's just because it's a stupid question.
It's a question that anyone who pushes the limits of risk will ultimately face.
I don't know. Maybe it's just another pathology, an addiction.
Perhaps there's a glitch in my brain.
I battle with that a lot. Of like, what are you doing? There's no answer to why we're up there and why we're into risking ourselves and, you know, up in the mountains. It's just. It's fun to be out in the mountains having a good time.
For as long as people have been tying into the sharp end, the reason has been elusive. Sir Edmund Hillary said he climbed for the hell of it. And old George Mallory, his answer was, because it's there. Looking for answers in the pages of climbing history, we come upon a surprising chapter. Over 100 years ago, deep in the sandstone towers scattered across the border of Germany and the Czech Republic, a cult of danger climbing arose unlike anything the world had ever seen. Visitors to this land will find that among a ragged band of beer-drinking former commies, the tradition of hard, scary climbing is still the rule.
We got a group of American trad climbers who've come over here. We're here to sample the ultimate trad climbing.
We had heard the area is a very bold climbing area, but really we have no clue what to expect.
Our travelers were lucky enough to be guided by the legendary German climber, Bernd Arnold.
My name is Bernd Arnold and I'm 61 years old. Klettern is for me a Lebensform. Zu Hause, ich bin zwischen den Felsen hier geboren und das ist sozusagen mein Lebensraum.
The first day, Bernd decides he's gonna introduce us to the climbing with a group free solo. He suggested taking all of our shoes off so we could feel the grains of sand on our feet. People just getting used to the rock and feeling free, scrambling about.
I didn't really realize it until I got here, but this was pretty much the birth of modern free climbing. In the late 1800s, already people were starting to do gnarly technical free climbs on these towers. And back in the 60s and 70s, Bernd Arnold He was revolutionizing free climbing as we know it.
Mitte der 60er Jahre alle schweren Routen, die es hier gab. Und dann war es folgerichtig, dass ich ja dann auch verstärkt neue Routen geklettert habe.
These were by far the hardest and scariest climbs in the world at the time.
Arnold's high standard became a legacy for those who followed.
30 years ago when I started climbing was the goal of climber, make some route which is so bad protected, make very hard to repeat, make first ball 20, 30 meters over the ground. Not only hard climbing, but also hard mentally.
The local rules, passed down over generations to preserve the rock, are fairly simple. First of all, you can't use chalk, which marks up the cliffs. And, unlike everywhere else in the world, you can't protect the cracks with metal gear, like nuts or cams. So, when faced with a typically massive runout between bolts, what you're left with are little pieces of rope tied into knots.
I like climbing with this knot. For you, it must be hard to believe that the knot will hold you.
Shit.
Think it might be for you real, like scary.
If you climb some route, if you fall, you can become legend. Or I go in hospital with broken leg, which is also funny sometimes. You go on the sharp end, make your nuts ready, and start climbing.
It's a whole new mind game, for sure.
These are.
I wasn't trusting it when I was up there.
The classic crack climbs are parallel sided, and you can't get any gear at all. Every once in a while, you come to a spot that has a constriction where you would pull off what you hope is the right size and put it in there, and can't really tell if they're good or bad. Get in there! I usually just yank on them a whole bunch. This place is definitely the scariest place I've ever climbed.
Then you get out on the phases, and there's no chalk. Yeah, you don't have a clue where you're going. All of the talismans that you have against the danger of climbing are kind of taken away from you, and you're left with just you.
Whoa!
It's just the beginning when the bowl gets to your feet. You go and you go and you go and you go before you get another piece of gear. I thought I was gonna fall like 100 feet out of that thing at one point.
Fucking scary.
Probably one of the best pitches of rock climbing I've ever done.
The climbs here are definitely like vision quests. You're just like, all right, here we go.
Climbing into the unknown, like no chalk, no nothing. It's pretty rad. Do I wish every place in the world was like this? Hell no.
It's really quite adventurous. You don't know where you're going. Half the time you're soloing, because it's super run out.
Even Alex, who's probably the best climber here, the first thing he asked Bernd was, what's the easiest climb here?
I don't want to break my legs. I don't want to do anything that's too dangerous.
I think I'm supposed to place knots in here, except I don't know how to place knots.
My opinion of Arnold is that he's the best bold climber in the world right now.
Ooh, knot placement.
So it was good to see him get a little scared.
This is like kind of a joke.
Sketchy, sketchy face climbs, slingy little thread throughs, running it out 40 feet between ring bolts. It's kind of mind-blowing. You show up here and you can't even believe that these guys developed this style of climbing. You know, you're kind of like, the heck, guys? Like, this is dangerous. It's just the craziest climbing I've ever seen. Major props to the homies here in Eastern Europe.
We met a lot of climbers on this trip, and one of them that sticks out the most is Robert.
I'm Robert Leisner. I find the climbing as the sport of my life.
It's super crazy, like no chalk, 514 is like desperate.
It is one of the longest difficult routes here. It brings our 5 meters to another. After a really hard situation, you relax in this fly.
Woo! You like that?
I liked it, yeah.
He is very similar to us in the aspect that he really is psyched on pushing the difficulty barrier, like keeping style and ethics in mind.
It's also possible to climb very hard here without chalk.
Robert is rad, going for it, ground up, establishing 514s with no chalk. That's cutting edge, new school climbing for sure.
Woohoo!
By the second week of their trip, the Americans were hungry to make their mark on the local scene.
Yeah, the Arete day.
The Arete fiasco.
Peter Sandy.
So Cedar wanted to climb this Arete, one of the most beautiful Aretes I've ever seen. And then these Germans we were climbing with started talking to him about how dangerous it was.
The possibility of you fall.
So you hit the ground, you're saying?
It could be.
I was psyched until he gave me the beta.
The Germans are just like, oh, it's the most dangerous, most dangerous.
It's crazy, you don't want to climb. Like, you don't want to die, you want to have fun. You know?
I mean, it's fucking proud, dude. It's one of the scariest climbs here, they said.
Not sure.
I think you should do it.
Alex starts egging him on to do it.
Honnold's whole no big deal approach to climbing, it's like nothing is a big deal to him.
You should do it. Just go up there and do some rock climbing. I think it's no big deal.
He just wanted to see me like have some success on this really scary run out climb, but
I don't know, man.
They got inside his head and he started thinking maybe he shouldn't do it. Psyched him out.
It was the 100-foot whipper that really got me unpsyched. Other than that, it looks like a great route.
We've been sitting here for an hour talking about how it's
sketchy.
It's so scary and so hard, and so, like, we might as well just go up there and find out.
Well, you should go do it then, dude.
Yeah, do the Arete. Honnold was just like, fuck it, I'll do it. You know, like, sacked up, took one for the team.
We'll see how scared I get.
See, if I break my legs, you better destroy all this footage. But, like,
it's real up there.
Alex kind of just shut it all out and started slowly up the Arete.
Yeah, it was definitely intense. It was like everybody was kind of on edge.
Shit is really sandy.
He hesitated for a good 10 minutes on these sloping friggin' Arete features, just looking at potentially like a 90-foot fall that could have been really terrible. So it was a full free solo headspace.
Just slow, controlled.
Steady as she goes, taking your time.
Watching Alex was pretty inspiring because he kept it together so well, even when he was so far above his gear that he would have fallen pretty much almost to the ground. So that's pushing it pretty close to the limit. Footholds were breaking and it looked super, super exciting. I don't think it's a pitch that I'd want to lead.
Alex is in a different headspace. His ability to stay calm and not get pumped all the way to the top.
Yeah, Alex gets respect, man. I think he's a badass kid.
Yeah.
You know, I'm definitely a little jealous. He's kind of the superhero I always wished I was. But as Clint Eastwood said, man's got to know his limitations.
I think the Czech big tradition, older nation, is we drink beer a lot. I don't mean like a lot, but 8-10 beers every day was a standard. I have some frosty.
Welcome to Adelbad.
So it's 10 in the morning, we're already drinking, we're about to go tower jumping, and this is how you get warmed up for it.
It's tradition.
Here in Czech, doing the jumping between tower just because you won't move from one tower to other. But then come the idea, okay, we make from this some kind of sport. But the jump is always very dangerous. Always is broken leg or broken the head, so I don't think it's good idea come to here and make a hard jump.
I've linked up with one of the most psyched tower jumpers here in the Czech.
Jumping is my life.
Yeah, so I'm gonna be following Peter around on a few jumps here, so we'll see how it goes. Here we go. Woo! Yeah, I didn't break my ankle. Sweet. This one's called Broken Bones, which isn't exactly the most encouraging name.
Yes. No.
Not that bad.
Dude, yeah. Don't do that one.
Okay. Come on.
I think I can jump from down here.
Doing these insane jumps between towers. It's a really unique and fun climbing culture here. It's unlike anything I've ever experienced.
It's not broken, it's good.
Can I give these guys props for making it so scary and dangerous?
I'm going for it, Campy!
There's plenty of safe places to go climbing in the world. Woo! Woo! This definitely isn't one of them.
The amazing thing I think about this area is once you top out, you're in this wide open expanse. For me, it's been really inspiring. I have a lot of respect for all the people that I've met in the Czech Republic. In their strong will to follow their own tradition, something that no one else in the world is doing.
The climbers and the people who like the area here, or who climbed here, and who are die.
Unfortunately, my cousin, Martinenka.
It's really meaningful to travel halfway around the world and have a common ground of climbing.
Die Motivation verschiebt sich mit dem Alter immer ein bisschen. Und heute ist eigentlich so meine Motivation, wenn ich klettern gehe, so leicht, das Schwere so leicht wie möglich zu machen. Der Knochen schon gebrochen, aber ich bin immer wieder auf die Beine gekommen.
Our visit to Eastern Europe confirms that the history of the Sharp End is littered with broken bones. But it's still not exactly clear why someone would go in for that kind of ride. Maybe it's time to turn our gaze from the past to the here and now. So if Eastern Europe is the cradle of Sharp End climbing, then its modern day proving ground is Yosemite Valley. For the past 50 years, Yosemite climbers have been defining the standard for big wall climbing. And that standard remains at the cutting edge, much thanks to one man.
Hi.
I'm AD.
I'm Ammon McNeely, local Yosemite bum.
Ammon McNeely is probably the most accomplished big wall climber in the world right now.
Why the hell did I climb these walls? For God's sakes, it fucking makes my balls drop.
Seems that I'm pretty good at hard aid for some reason. If you're on a hard pitch, you'll get a series of body weight placement only. So it can hold your body weight, But if you fall on it, it's going to generate enough force to rip it out of the wall.
Aid climbing's one of those sports where it's so scary because you're standing on stuff that is just terrible. You're kind of in this perpetual state of, is this going to hold? Am I going to take a big fall? And Ammon just doesn't seem to worry about that. You know, everyone in Yosemite has a nickname, and Ammon is the El Cap Pirate.
I guess I'm just piratical in my nature. I got a rough look about me.
He just kind of embodies going hard, having fun.
The yellow bag. We're almost to the golden nipple.
Talking like a pirate for 3 or 4 days. My partner's like, shut the fuck up. We're done with the pirate already. Are you, matey? We'll have to keelhaul you for that one.
He is taking the captain by storm and finding just the craziest, steepest lines and doing whatever it takes to get through.
A lot of times you're just on these hooks over an edge of the rock. And you're like, all right, just get through this section. And I try to go through it, test my pieces, get up on it, and don't think about it to get to the better placements. Part of the thrill is because you know, yeah. This is hardcore, this is a real deal. I could get fucked up. I could get hurt right here.
Okay, hold there! Flat! Flat, please!
Being up there, you know, you can get to places where few people travel. The amazing perspective on life. Yeah, it makes you really love life, you know, scaring the hell out of yourself.
While I was photographing Ammon McNealy, he was climbing on a climb called Surgeon General.
Third solo ascent of Surgeon General. Took this nasty fall. I banged my head really good, cracked my helmet. Tom saw me through his telescope.
And that's where he fell from, all the way down to where his belay is.
I heard this scream. He was hanging from the end of the rope, sort of upside down, motionless, with his arms strung out, and I couldn't believe it.
Pulled my helmet off. It was kind of some white, pussy, oozy looking stuff. I shook it off, you know, sat on that ledge for about 30 minutes. Helicopter ended up coming and trying to rescue me. And of course, I was having none of it, mate.
Do you need help?
It's all good if I fail. I can live with that. But if I fail, I'm going to get myself out of the mess.
You do not need help, and you want us to go away. Correct.
I'm like, all right, they're down there watching me. I think I'm just going to have to get back up there and start climbing, and then maybe they'll go away. And sure enough.
Good practice. It was very good practice.
We're all going to die one of these days. You know, it's a matter of time. I would rather live 40 years of excitement and fun and exhilarating and just woo, full volume than 80 years of la-da-da-da-da, you know, boring.
Yeah, man.
Why not get out there and live it?
Life's pretty good here in Yosemite Valley, baby. Woo, yeah! Woo! Yeah, baby!
The primordial fear of falling has apparently lost its impact on some people. So where do they go next to find the fear? Object lesson, Chris McNamara.
Chris, oh man, he is a nut. He's a little out there like me.
Chris Mack is a veteran wall climber who is looking for the next big high. He found it on the way down.
I started climbing big walls when I was 14, and I saw a base jumper go by me while I was on El Capitan. In my mind, I always thought, okay, that's something one day I'm going to do.
Yeah, be careful, man. You're base jumping.
I kind of got through the learning curve, but I think I was sort of lucky.
Like this? No, don't do that because you're spinning it the wrong way. And when it comes back, dive over the top and just do a straight dive like onto your head. Yep. Only slightly off-heading.
After the first jump, it was pretty much impossible to stop.
Chris Mack is an interesting jumper. He definitely went pretty crazy, especially in the beginning, and a lot of people started warning him and be like, hey dude, you're not going to be able to push it that long.
I wasn't planning to open there.
Now he's a pretty experienced flyer.
Sorry about that.
Yeah, he's a really experienced flyer now. I'm originally from Europe, and it's great to come back and get to fly all these cliffs.
Europe's the best place to base jump in the world because they let you jump off pretty much anything you want, and there's some of the largest cliffs and with big, big jumps. When you're wingsuit base jumping, at first you're falling, getting that feeling of dead air, your stomach falls out. It's that last moment where you're like, what did I just do? But then within only 3 or 4 seconds, you're actually moving forward really fast. You feel the air almost like you're flying forward at 100 miles an hour, which you are. Kind of the whole appeal is that you get this freedom to go wherever you want to go. Explore a new part of the wall. You aim for some features, get real close, kind of skim along the surface. You really only feel speed when there's something relative to you.
Each time you fly next to a cliff, well, the next jump, you want to go maybe even closer, and you got to draw the limit at some point and realize that you probably don't want to go too close.
I could see this bush coming up, and I was like, ooh, I want to go fly close to that. And then as I got closer and closer, I went, ooh, wait, maybe I'm flying a little too close. I don't know, maybe I was a foot or two above it.
You have like a tiny little wind gust, or you make a tiny little mistake, you can be in the cliff.
Once you get to the summit, there's definitely a bit of an edge in the air.
Over that slatty area, like a couple hundred feet, and then do a pretty hard right turn back.
In the end, the most important thing is to be relaxed. It's in the middle of that. You just breathe and chill.
10 seconds.
10!
5 seconds. 3, 2, 1, see ya.
I have had, you know, a pretty bad experience base jumping where I was jumping with someone who died. That definitely made me rethink the whole sport. I'm never base jumping anymore unless I really think it's worth it and I think it's safe, because there's nothing worth dying for. I never set out to push it too hard. You're only doing it if you feel in control, but you just have those flights where just everything clicks and it feels really good, and you just go for it. Wingsuit base jumping is kind of the coolest thing I've ever done.
Yeah!
Woo! So when you have a really good flight, it is about as good as it gets.
Chris Mack may be onto something here. That moment, out there on the edge, where our fear and confidence collide. And of all the styles of climbing, maybe the best way to get to that place is free soloing.
Got no time, got no mind.
To be able to free solo something, that is an expression of being so in control that you know you're gonna be able to do it without falling. There is a pretty strong mental dialogue and a pretty strong engagement with fear.
Time to sink away.
It's hard to push past that fear. It's something that for me takes a lot of thought, a lot of preparation. and I don't have to be paralyzed by fear. I can just go do it.
No matter what the discipline, Steph Davis is always pushing her limits.
There are certain times when I want to do the hardest thing I can. If I'm climbing with a rope, I'm usually thinking about difficulty to push myself to the point of falling. If I'm climbing my hardest, you know, there's going to be a lot of times where you're sort of out of control, and, you know, that can be really appealing. But at the same time, I want this sense of mastery to be really, really solid. With free solo climbing, it's about raising the level at which I feel solid.
Raising the level of ropeless climbing has led Steph to her most committing route yet, the 1,000-foot per vertical sanctuary on the legendary Long's Peak Diamond.
When I was younger, climbing up here all the time, it was like this humongous dream of mine to free solo the diamond. But if I'm gonna go up there and do that where it's death consequences, I have to figure out how to have the right mindset and what that means to me, and I'm gonna really learn something. Climbing is pretty steep. It's vertical or overhanging. If you fell off, you'd go down about 1,000 feet. The crux section is a good handful of moves that you have to kind of maintain throughout there. It is a little steeper, so you're not totally on your feet. It's a little more strenuous. I'm just looking at the rock, thinking, be relaxed, have good feelings. To me, soloing something like this, it's really about being in an environment where there's a lot of risk and controlling yourself. If you can control yourself, you're gonna be safe. That's the challenge.
As the years go by, the standards that define the cutting edge get pushed further and further. And we're already catching glimpses of the future. When you can free solo beyond the realm of control to the point of falling.
That's always been the scariest part in climbing, is falling. Or right before you're going to fall. When I thought about free soloing, I think about the moment over and over again of when I would detach from the rock, and that would be it. It would be my death.
Having a base rig on seemed just like the obvious ultimate idea.
when I have the rig on, I know there's more after that point where I detach from the rock.
Fuck. Thickening clouds on the Eiger make a safe base exit impossible, forcing Dean to reverse back down the climb. But even getting to that moment, where the fall potential is real, and the only protection is a 6-pound base parachute, has been the culmination of many disciplines, like big wall climbing, free soloing, highlining,
maybe a little bit right of that.
Then yeah. Base jumping. Which led to the baseline.
The idea that I once had that falling was death. Now falling is control, and that's a great thing to be able to change. You know, instead of dying, I'm flying. For me, a big door is opened. And I'm seeing the world now through different eyes.
For Dean, the bass solo is the next logical step. But the concept remains relatively untested. Dean has taken the fall on other cliffs, but the north face of the Eiger, with thousands of feet of alpine limestone, is unpredictable.
At this point, there's still a lot of uncertainty about what happens when I fall.
My whole body's tingling. Really aware of the exposure, you know, and then I break through into that calm, focused, heightened awareness that attracts me to all these things. Just cued into the texture of the rock and my contact, and still pretty much hugging onto the solid earth. The thing that I'm getting out of pushing my limits is that I turn
impossible to possible. I turn something I haven't done to something I'm doing. But the possibilities of what we're capable of doing, if we believe in it, is the most compelling thing I can think of.
Our exploration into this world of high adventure has come to an end, but only for now, because there will always be people out there reaching for the next big challenge on the sharp end.
In case there's no repetition, a personal unsound mind, who then issues your...
The sharp end is where you feel confident and you feel that you're in your element, that you can kind of push yourself to the most challenging and the most intense situation.
When you were scared, when it seemed like it wasn't going to happen, all of those things add to the joy of actually pulling it off.
You get to the top and you got sand in your eyes and you're all bloody and barely freaking able to breathe, but you're psyched, you know, you're psyched because you pulled it off.
It feels like you're doing something proud. It feels like you're accomplishing something for yourself by being up there and going through this adventure, this ordeal.
It frees you from the whole doubt in your system if you can just go for it.
That's what it is. It's just going for it. That's the sharp end.
I hope he's watching us right now. He's listening in. Here you are, Steve. All the best. We're here, man. Cheers.
On the sharp end, you need strong spirit. Woo.